and welcome to the Fence Girl Speaks. Today is... it's Wednesday. And it's December 17th. This is episode 100 or something. Hi, Oreo! I'm Mary Beth, also known as the Fat Squirrel. I'm your hostess, the Fat Squirrel on Ravelry, and the Fat Squirrel SQRRL on Instagram. Good morning. It's morning time. It is 8:15, to be exact. I know, right? I was supposed to record yesterday. Craziness happened. It didn't go down. I do have stuff to show you, though. Shush your face, it's true. But first let's do shenanigans! Okay, we have no actual shenanigans, right? I mean, we have shenanigans, but like of inconsequential value. It's true. So let's talk about stuff I did. Actually, let's just rant, because that's really what this is going to be. You don't want to see a rant, just fast forward. It's not filled with hatred or anything. It's not mean to you. It's mean to the retail community. It's not even about Christmas. Excuse me. However, this week we had to go find Tova. Tova is my daughter. She is almost 8. Oh my gosh, it's almost her birthday. She's one of those Capricorns that have the birthday right before Christmas. So she's just going to grow up and be better. Sorry, kid. You're on the bitter train. She's fine right now, but any minute she's going to get better. But anyway, we, on a sadder note, which I will try not to go, well, that's weird, but, okay, this is awkward for a moment, but my husband's father passed away, and we needed to go to his memorial service. Well, and it's okay. His wife passed in the end of June, and he was ready. We originally thought that he would go first. He had cancer, and it had spread into his bones, and we thought that he would go first, but he held on long enough for her to be gone and to get everything tied up, and then he was obviously ready to go. So he left us, and we had to go to his memorial service, and we needed something for the child to wear, because the child, and now this is going to sound like I'm the most vain person in the world, because I'm going to make this transition between, like, a memorial service and retail. Yeah, it's a reality, people. I don't know how else to say it. So, it was not the first thing on my mind at all, of course. And so, like, the week of, I thought, oh, crud, because he actually passed on Thanksgiving. So, we actually had, like, 2 weeks' notice before the memorial service, because it's cremated. But I just wasn't in that place to be thinking about that stuff. So, the practical side of things. And so, like, the week of, I realized that my child only owns... she really is into textures. She really only owns, like, velour and fleece clothing and uniforms for school. So, I thought she had a sweater, and I went to get it out, and it was no longer fitted upon her person in any kind of reasonable way. So we had to last minute go out into the world to find her clothing. Well, originally I thought I would just go after my chiropractor. It's Deer in the Ball. And I don't go there ever. I haven't been to the mall in... has it been 2 years? I don't know. It's been a long time. As a fat lady, they don't have stuff for me there, so what's the point? So, and I just don't like to shop very much at all. I do like to buy some stuff on the internets. Don't get me wrong. I'm still a bad person. I just don't like to shop in the real world with humans. So this is getting really ranty and wrong. I'm sorry. And I just am feeling like I'm a terrible person. But whatever, I'm just going to keep talking. Talk through it. So I thought, I'll just go and get her something, like, at a department store or something after I have a chiropractor appointment, and that'll be good. But now she's apparently at the age where she no longer is just willing to, like, she's not a fashion-y kid at all. I mentioned the terry cloth. Not the terry cloth. She's not wearing towels. I mentioned the fleece and velour thing. She's not really fashion at all. But so for some reason, she was like, well, I would really prefer to pick out what I'm wearing. So she was like looking online for everything because she's my kid. I'm like, dude, it's not going to get here in time. We do not have, I'm not spending $30 on overnight shipping to get it here on time. So we actually have to go into the world. And she was like, well, that's fine. So one day after school, we got her and we went to Target and Kohl's. I figured between the two of them, there will be something that is appropriate. Really? Target and Kohl's? Now again, I could have purchased something from like a Land's End or a... I'm not a conservative person at all. Like, I recently read one of those, like, things not to wear after you're 30. And approximately 7 things on that list were things I wear all the time. Graphic tees, overalls. I'm not a grown-up. I'm not conservative. But, you know, when you're going to a thing, it's all about the code switching, right? You know, you don't want to distract from the actual thing that's happening by looking like a ridiculous fool. So I did not wear a graphic tee, obviously. So appropriately for the child, I also wanted to find something. And she's not a sparkly, spangly kid. I mean, okay, that's not true. She had sparkly shoes and she went crazy for them. But she, you know, I'm not going to get sparkle, spangle, 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 spangle for that situation. It's not a look at me time. Okay? There's nothing. Girl clothing is ridiculous. Ridiculous. Now, I know that there are some places and some people on Instagram were very nice and were like suggested other places we could have gone that maybe we'd have found something. And I'm sure if we'd gone to like a large, like a Macy's or something, maybe we would have found something better. But I just wasn't in that headspace. It was after school, it was the whole thing. But oh my gosh, what is going on with Target and Kohl's girls' departments? I knew Target was going to be a gamble because they love some rhinestones up in that place. But Kohl's? I thought Kohl's was like the most conservative, like, no offense, but kind of boring. Like when I worked at a professional job, sometimes I would get clothes there because they had like traditional conservative clothing. Not for little girls. It was crazy. Crazy. For one thing, I don't want to use a curse word. But it's a hot mess in there. It's like Goodwill. Like we're nothing, I can't shop at Goodwill. I know everybody's like, Goodwill, thrifting. I can't go into a Goodwill because there's so, I can't look for things by color. Like that's how all of our Goodwills are organized. They're not by like size or, I can't do it. Like it's not in me. I am not in any way like a clean freak or anything like that. But when I am spending money in a stressful situation, I cannot deal also with insane disorganization. I just can't. Makes me crazy. Kohl's has approximately 9,000 different things on 4 racks. What is that about? I mean, really, there's like, so you have to look through every single piece of clothing and none of it makes any sense. A, everything is short-sleeved. What is that about? It's either like velvet and ruffles for, I know it's holiday time, right? It's like velvet and ruffle party dresses, short-sleeved chunky acrylic knit sweater dresses. What? I don't even know what to do with that. Do you know? I don't know what to do with that. I'm not fashion enough to know what to do with that. Certainly my 8-year-old is not almost 8-year-old. Lace overlay on everything. There were several things that had vinyl accents, like, not vinyl, like, pleather. What? We found one thing in 2 stores. I did not like the thing, but at least it was, like, normal looking, for lack of a better word. It's still acrylic. Oh. Don't ever let a Kohl's catch on fire. It'll be like a nuclear meltdown place. What is up with the insane, unnatural fabrics? I know, I just went to the wrong places. I know, you're telling me that right now. You're just shaking your head like you went to the wrong places. I know I went to the wrong places, but those were not places I knew were wrong. I need to be a better shopper, apparently. Or I just need to have backup outfits. That's what I need to do. But man, it's so hard. I can't think of everything. Are you a parent? Are you like the primary house person in your family? Like the household's my gig. I can't think of everything. How am I supposed to know exactly how much milk is in the refrigerator? How much dog food there is left? If that sweater that my kid had from 2 years ago still fits, I should have known that one, right? Duh. Does my husband have socks? Is the lawn, does everybody have enough underwear? How can I know all of these things? I don't know how I know all these things. I usually don't. I usually mess up, as I just mentioned that I did. I can't know all the things. There's like all these studies where they're like, surprise, women are have more likely to have ADHD than we ever thought. I wonder why. I can never concentrate on anything without being like, oh, how much butter is in that refrigerator? I don't know how anything done. So if you're ever wondering why I don't take custom orders, can't add anything else to the plate, people. Can't add anything else to the plate. And I am not like one of these perfect women who has to have everything perfect. There's dishes in my sink. My bathroom totally needs cleaned. My kid's sweatshirt that she took off yesterday is still sitting on her chair. I have bras on the back of our couch. I'm not perfect in any way. There's always bras on the back of the couch. Because you whip those off as soon as you get home. I can't handle any more blood restriction. Hello, I've got too many things in my head. I don't know how this, like, they're automatons. If you're perfect, I don't think you're an automaton, but I don't know how you do it, quite frankly. It's crazy. Nuts. So this is the season where I have at least, like, a breakdown every other week where I was like, how was I supposed to know that? I'm sure some of you are right there with me. How are we supposed to know that? We don't know all the other things. Do you, other person who lives in this house, know if milk is left in the refrigerator? I don't even drink the milk or use the milk. Yet I somehow must know how many Ritz crackers. I don't eat Ritz crackers. Somehow I'm supposed to keep tabs on how many Ritz crackers. Not that anybody in this house is like literally upset with me that there are no more Ritz crackers in the house. There aren't, we're out. Nobody's like, ah, oh, why did you ruin the world by not having Ritz crackers? It's just a standard I hold for myself, which is stupid. I should just be like, whatever. You want Ritz crackers? Tell me. But then I get all like, oh, whatever. It's all about laughing through it, people. Just wear your hamburger helper sweater. Your North Allerton hat that's designed by the beautiful Kubnitz that you knit out of Quince and Company in the fingering weight one. Is that Finch? I believe that's Finch. Not the silk one, the regular one. With the giant pom-pom on it. Just roll on through. That's what you gotta do. So anyway, it's been kind of crazy. Let's talk about knitting and spinning, shall we? Now that I ranted, you're like, oh my gosh, what else has been happening? I feel like I shouldn't talk about knitting and spinning already. It's only been 100 minutes. Please stop talking. Oh, one thing I did want to mention. My husband and I watch a lot of television when I'm sewing and while I'm working and all that stuff. But my husband, much to my chagrin, I don't even know if chagrin is an appropriate word. But anyway, much to my consternation, that's a better word for it. Much to my consternation, my husband does not like episodic TV. He likes NCIS. All of the Trek things and the Stargate things. That's all he's on board for. Nothing else. Nothing else. Oh my gosh, there's new seasons of Poirot. Are you on Netflix? There's more Poirot! aside. Oh, but so one thing is I want to talk about that we've been watching that he is actually really liking, and I'm surprisingly liking too. So he loves a documentary. I like documentaries, don't get me wrong, but like his only fair, other than the shows I mentioned, is like all the Marvel movies, Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings. He's such a nerd. But like not in a way that I'm a nerd. We're opposing nerd forces. And documentaries, like that's it. And so, but we have been watching this one lately that's on Netflix now. It's called Myth Hunters. Have you seen that? It only has three of five stars, I think. So I was really like, because documentaries, much like a cozy mystery, can be great or awful. What is that? I don't know what the distinction is. What is it with cozy mysteries? They're terrible, right? You never know what you're getting when you get a cozy mystery. Some of them are awful. Some of them are totally pleasant. Agatha Raisin. But documentaries are like that too, right? You feel that, right? Like, I'm not going to watch anything else ever again about anything about the Freemasons. Ever. Thanks, Dan Brown. You ruined that for all of us. No, you didn't. Just all the people who glommed onto your fame did. Ever. No more Holy Grail. I can't watch another one. Like, those History Channel ones. And, like, not only that, they're made for, like, they are just so dumbed down, it's ridiculous. Like, after every commercial break, we're going to reiterate what happened in the four minutes that happened before the last commercial break. Anyway, documentaries would be terrible. They should even call them. They should just call them nonfiction television. Anyway. But, so I was like, three stars, all these are going to be awful. Totally enjoyable. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that they were enjoyable. And this is why they're enjoyable, to me anyway, is that they are about the actual myth hunters. It's documentaries, and they have, for one thing, they have a lot more variety. It's two seasons on Netflix. Excuse me. Alien nose scratch. They have a lot more variety in their topics. Probably because it's a series and they have to stretch, you know. They can't just do one special and be done. So there's one about the Dutchman's gold. There's been one about sunken treasure ships, like the Spanish fleet of 1612 or something. I don't know, 1522, something. Some sort of rape of the Americas. What else has there been? There's been like the, what do they call those? The religious artifacts? You're yelling at me right now, aren't you? I can't think what they're called. Anyway, you know, the religious artifacts that are associated with, like, religious, you know, thing, like Joan of Arc's thumb, Joan of Arc's bones. Why can't I think of them? I don't know why I can't think of that word. Anyway, so it's pretty big. There's a lot of Nazi ones. The Nazis were great. I don't even want to talk about that. Why did I just say that? That was stupid. But anyway, do you know what I mean? Like, there's all about the occult and Himmler and all that stuff. So there's like really a wide variety, but it's not actually about the object that they're looking for. Like, yes, that is part of the story, but the majority of the story is actually about the people that are obsessed looking for these things. And that is what is so interesting. But I enjoyed it. I don't know. I wouldn't say it's like, you know, top 10 TV shows of all time in any way, but it's a pleasant way if you have a partner who only watches documentaries. Again, it's an interesting story. It's stories that a lot of them I have never even, like, I didn't know anything about Joan of Arc's thigh bones. Why can I not think of that word? It's driving me crazy. You know, I'm going to try. I don't even know how to Google that. What are religious artifacts called? What are the religious, religious bones? What is that? I don't even know what do I Google? I don't even know what to Google to find that word. Relics. Thank you. Thanks, Google. But so anyway, that's what's so interesting. It's all about the actual people. And it's you know, they're obsessed. They become just obsessed with this thing. And it's so interesting to watch. So that's been fun. My daughter's been really in love with Dogs with Jobs. She likes a pet show, animal show. I just ignore them. But then yesterday, she's watching the last one of the last one. It's like the season two last one. And there was part of the, it's like three shows and like vignettes or whatever. And there was one about Bozo, who is a helper, like a physical assistant dog. I missed the beginning part. I have no idea what the disability of the woman is, but she's wheelchair bound and seems to have not like a muscle control in her upper torso very much. Like if she falls forward, she can't pull herself back up. But anyway, that's like a lot of, totally cried. I'm not a crier. Oh my gosh. Cried. a good pet show will do that to you, won't it? Just make it tear up. It was really beautiful. Even if you don't like, well, I guess I should say, even if you don't like pet shows. I'm not recommending the rest of the season. I have no idea what it's about. Well, I mean, I do. But I mean, I have no idea if the rest of it was that good. I doubt it. But this was so beautiful. The woman was, like, so deeply thankful for what the dog had given her. And, like, it was just this beautiful, synergistic relationship, which, oh. Anyway. Clipped again, just thinking about it. Oh my gosh, really, now I've just talked so much that it's ridiculous, quite frankly. I should move on. Actual dating at minute 21, if you're interested. I'll try to remember to put that out there. Let's talk about spinning. I totally have some. I haven't had any alone time. If you're new. I finished. This is not the particular order of finishedness, but whatever. I finished. Bam. I was making some singles. This is Fat Cat Knits in the Sweet Torty colorway. It's a 75% BFL, 25% Tessa Silk blend, which I find, per Juliana, to be really great for singles. So this is 8 ounces. It's somewhere about 600-ish yards. I didn't actually measure the circumference of my loop. I just know how many revolutions I had, but it's a pretty big loop. They are not fulled. They're just plain old. I didn't stretch them or anything, so you can see everyone's how there's a little kink. But really, overall, I was kind of afraid as I was spinning that second bobbin, the second 4 ounces, that it was going to be way overspun. But totally happy. I had, I think, 2 breaks as I was winding it onto the skein winder, which for singles I'm okay with. Or just pulled apart as I was, you know, taking it from the bobbin onto the skein winder. So I think that's pretty, I'm pretty okay with that. It's knit up, it'll have a lot more strength. I don't know if you can really tell how pretty it is, but I really like it. I had spun the first 4 ounces like a bajillion years ago. It's still a little damp. A bajillion years ago. And then I just didn't spin anything. I may have bought way too much Christmas sock yarn. I really need to stop buying yarn. Anyway. Although the other day I had a handbag and I looked in the little, you know, sometimes the handbags, they used to, I don't think they do it anymore. They had like a little vinyl window. And they would put, like, a calendar for that year in there. 2006. So I do buy way too much yarn, but I got a good 8 years out of that handbag. It's not like because it's in the rotation with 27 other ones. No. So anyway, justify myself like you care. Anyway, it's really pretty. Do you like it? I think it's really pretty. Oh! I totally am very pleased with it. So yay that. And then the next thing I have finished is, so what I did is I had that 4 ounces and then I just stalled out forever. Oh, because I bought too much Christmas yarn. And so then I had so much stress about trying to get up that knit up all that Christmas sock yarn. Finally this week I was like, dude, let it go. It's not okay to be crazy and buy too much yarn, but don't all then just roll and be like completely unproductive and you're like disgust over yourself. Don't do it. It's not good. Well, it wasn't like I was rolling in disgust. It was just like, I was like, I really need to knit this, but then I didn't really want to knit it. So I was just not getting anything done. Between that and sewing, it was crazy. So just let that go. So now this second bit is from Inglenook Fibers, and that's Inglenook with an I, Fibers. This is the Caramel Apple colorway. It's Merino Shetland, Tar Heave Faux Cashmere, Bamboo Silk, Firestar, Angelina, and Silk Noil. And they look like this when you get them. They're like the little mini bats. But I love them. So this is what broke my spinning slump. Thanks, Inglenook. Thanks, Malia, for recommending them. They're like the little mini bats that look like this. So this colorway is called Delft Tile. And I got, they were next to each other, and I was like, yes! I want it! I'm gonna make a two-color something. Right. Wouldn't they be pretty striped together? But I was so pleasantly surprised. Can you see how much sparkle is on it? There's a really awesome amount of sparkle. It's not crazy. It's not like waste. It's not so much that it gets like confusing when you're trying to work with it. But it's just gorgeous. They're relatively smoothly blended. Here, I'll take one apart. Are we even... Is this just... Is maybe this is just dizzed off of a... I don't even know. Or maybe it's a bat that's been stripped. I can't tell. But they look like that. And they have a good, nice amount of like color-appropriate sparkle in them. They're beautiful. And you can spin them long draw. Or supported long draw or whatever. Which makes it go super fast and makes it super fluffy. So I said this was like a little bit less than 4 ounces. And it's about 400 yards. But it's very fluffy. Yay. So I have decided that this is my crack. I love a semi-solid batling. Took me a while to come to this conclusion. I love them. Because I love the batling idea. Like it's like one little thing and you finish the thing and you're like, yes. And you can make another thing or you can stop. You can finish spinning the little nugget. But sometimes with like the beautiful hobbledy hoy batlings, which are so gorgeous, which I have some of, but like sometimes I get a little bit stressed about how the colors are all going to work out and stuff. And it makes me a little bit like, semi-solid, no stress. You just spin it. Doesn't matter if you pick the ones in order. You don't have to think like, oh, when I apply it, is that going to like go with that? Should I do the thing similarly and try to line them up? There's no thought. You just get your bag and you spin it. I know, right? I'm terrible. I can't read archaic language, and now I cannot even think about spinning. Totally American. Anyway. Oh, I'm so lazy. But it's gorgeous. And you can spin it long draws. It's beautiful. It's all fluffy and woolly and good and sparkly. It's awesome. So I am really in love with the semi-solid batling. Love it. Right? How could you not love it? It's very exciting. Now, that is not to say, every time I see those multicolored batlings spun up, I always think, oh my God, they're going in. They're beautiful. But when I spin them, I'm always a little stressed out. I don't know. What do you do? Okay, so the last thing I'm working on is, I didn't bring the tag, but I have another one. It's from Yarn Geek Fibers. And it's her BFL Sparkle. And this particular colorway is called Peacocks Can Fly. Short distances. I got this one at the Kentucky Sheep and Wool. But this is the one I'm currently spinning. And this one is the same base, BFL Sparkle. This one is the Butimus colorway, which I got at my first knitting pipeline retreat, which was, well, I've been to two, so it was my first one. Oh my gosh, knitting pipeline retreat. So I had this moment where I was like, ooh, should I apply them together? Because you can see like right there and right there's a similar colors happening, you know? It's like, should I apply them together? But what I've decided to do is do each skein as a two-ply and then maybe they'll live together in a project. So this is the first 2 ounces of the Butimus. And it is, in fact, it's like not, it's more, it's getting washed out there. So yay that! So I'm not sure, sport decay-ish for the final, maybe. Maybe it'll be worse than I don't even know. I'm just doing it how it feels right. Because when you're not in the right mind to be doing something, you just gotta do what feels right. Try to overthink things. That's not good. Okay. Sorry, there's a bunch of, this is my husband's side of the table. And there are approximately 37 black screws here, which I don't know why they're here. So I keep jostling them. Anyway, knitting! Finished objects. Here we go. I finished some slippers to be felted at a later date. I'll show you them. I'll try to show you them after they're felted. These are the felted clogs by Fiber Trends. And I can't remember the name of the pattern writer. I think it's in the show notes. If not, it's on Ravelry. So there's those. I've just made those with plain old Peyton's Classic Wool in the worsted. Gray and red. And normally this would be red, but I didn't have enough. So just the inside's red. It's an accent. It's a pop. So yay that. I did something crazy. I don't know how. I got like a reverse row in the wrong color here and not here. I did something wrong, but I kept checking it to see if it was the right width and counted the things and whatever. It's done. It's getting felted. It's going to be fine. So there are those. And they're dynamic. They're as long as my forearms. They're hot mitts. Ready to go. It's barbecue. So those are done. Yay. Well, they're not done, but they're ready to be washed and shrunken into a human-sized thing. Oh, and I want to talk about too. I have made those for myself, and then I wear them out because maybe I might wear them onto the porch to get mail or something, and then I wear holes in them. So I've been on like a super, I'm not making those for myself anymore because they take, you know, a decent amount of time. They take a decent amount of yarn. Those will fit a U.S. men's 9 or 10. And they took 3 skeins, no, 2 skeins of gray and a skein and a half of red. So, you know, 3.5-4 skeins of yarn. and it has to be wool because it's felted. It's not an inexpensive slipper if you're good. I mean, I don't mind kind of make them if they're going to last for any amount of time. But if when I make them and they last for me like a month or two, I'm like, well, pshh. So, and I've never really liked those slipper bottoms. But this year, I bought these. And these are little sew-on, you know, heels and toes. Leather bottoms. And I really like, I have not used them yet, but I'm confident that I'm going to like them. I'm going to try them out on a pair for myself. Actually, a pair of my husband's has a hole in them, so I might use them on those. But they're nice and heavy. I got another pair here. These are from Lavender Hill Knits. She also has her own slipper pattern. And she ships out of New Hampshire. And I believe the men's is $12.95, but I could be a total liar. Not sure. But she also has really cute stitch markers. She's in a sample. And I also may have bought some gnomes, which I'll show you in a minute. Gnomes and mushroom combo. but they are, we have the pre-holes, so you can just stitch them right on. And I bought another pair from another Etsy seller. And they are much thinner and much smaller. So I really prefer these. So this is a comparison. And she gives you the little nylon-y string just to tie them on with. So you can see the heels, these are both for men. So these would be great. Now this company does have them in different colors. And I don't have her name. She does have the different colors. Lavender Hill only has browns. And it varies by whatever. Goodbye Nora Jean. So G-O-O-D-B-U-I. B-U-Y, like a goodbye, like a good deal. Goodbye, Nora, N-O-R-A, Jean, G-J-E-A-N. Oh my gosh! I'm just gonna lie down again. I've had coffee. It's always like this if you're new. I can't even use that as an excuse. Anyway, so these are much smaller and much thinner. I think these would be great for maybe like a child slipper or something where this might be too rigid. And maybe they would be just as durable. I actually have no idea. But I like the thought of these better. But that's with no actual authority to my comment because I know nothing about anything. Except I like the way that one feels better. So, that's what I'm going with. So anyways, I got those to go on slippers. I don't know, we'll see how it works. Well, I have it in my hand. Oh my gosh! The only good thing that came out of that crazy retail experience, if you're on Instagram, you know this already. Burt's Bees makes a pumpkin spice lip balm. Shut the front door. It may be special, only available seasonally. Came in a package with vanilla. Vanilla is fine. It's not super strong vanilla scented. This is not super strong scented either. Like it smells when you smell it. When you have it on, yeah, it doesn't really smell. Which is good because I'm too many scents gets me confused. But I really like it because it feels like it's actually moisturizing your lips. You know what I mean? Like, I don't feel like I have to put it on every hour. It's like twice a day, which is about enough. I tried those EOS, like those little ball things. Maybe there's something weird about my body chemistry. Those are terrible for me. They make my lips crack. I had to put them on like every 20 minutes. I do love the application. Like that, like whoop. You don't even have to like smear it around. You just, whoop. Like it's the ultimate in laziness. And I really think they're cute. But boy, they did not work for me at all. This is even better, I think. This is even better than the traditional one. The traditional one has menthol in it, or peppermint. Peppermint has menthol in it, right? Anyway, I don't know. But it has that really cold feeling, which I love, and I love the way it smells. But it also dries out my lips a little bit. This, however, winner, winner. Random other things. Spout. Shush. Just go along on the trip with me. Fast forward. Put me at 2x. You won't understand me when I tell you. Oh my gosh, I was so excited about these things. I've actually wanted these for like 3 years. I've never been willing to spend the money on them. I think they're like $7 or $8. But it's a, I sewed extra bags so I could get some this year. These are the scentsicles, and this is called Christmas Time Spruce. They smell so good in the jar. Oh my gosh, they smell so good. We have an artificial tree. Oh my gosh, they smell so good. And they smell super awesome for about 4 days. Now I can't smell them anymore. Oh, the disappointment. I have still two in there. I'm saving till right before Christmas. Put them up on the Christmas. They're just like a little doodad. And then they have a little hook, which is very attractive. I mean, it's just a little wire thing, but it's still very pretty. That you can hook on. There's a little hole in the end. And you just hook it through there, and then you hang them on the tree. And they, again, for the first 4 days, was awesome. And it says on here that every 2 weeks you should put a couple extra on there. But I don't know if it's just because we're desensitized to it now, because that happens. And maybe that's why it doesn't smell. Or if it, but I even went up and smelled the sticks, and they don't really smell anymore. But they smelled so good for 4 days. Oh, it smells so good. So I'm saving these last two for, like, maybe Christmas Eve. So what we've done in the meantime is gone back to the old standby. Did you ever use these when you were a kid? That's right. Balls are for incense. Do you not love that packaging? I love when they hold on to the packaging. Yes! Give me the nostalgic packaging! Because you never changed it. Not because it's a throwback, but because you never changed it. Thank you. Which don't smell as good, but do smell sort of like burnt trees. Which, you know, what do you do? Hopefully none of your bags smelled like burnt trees. I tried to put them aside. Anyway, what else was I talking about? Oh, I was still talking about knitting. I still have another finished object. Shut up, Mr. I finished my sport weight socks. These are dyed by Desert Vista Dye Works. This is the O. Clark colorway. I said that was a sport weight, right? Yes, I did. Usually I'm a 72 stitch on a fingering weight. These are 56. I really should have probably done 60. I went one size up from my normal needle. I usually knit on double points. I usually knit on zeros. And I did go one size up for these because they're pretty. The sport weight is a very hardy sport weight. It's not. It's heavier than like a socks that rock medium weight. So yeah, they're done. And I found out that this is actually, is it the vanilla latte? But Ooh Fancy Pants does a pattern. It's actually written up with the stitching in there. So Ooh Fancy Pants. I believe it's called Vanilla Latte, but I'm, there was so much stuff stuck to my lip balm right now. I should not wear lip balm when making out with fiber. That's just good information for you for the future. Right? Right. I'm never going to be able to find it, but it's Ooh Fancy Pants. Yay her! So there's that. Okay. Oh, that was glitter sparkle from something else. Oh my gosh. Okay, so now for works in progress. Speaking of socks that rock medium weight, segue. I am knitting the Angry Elf colorway. He's such an angry elf. Oh, elf. It's really the, so good. And I'm knitting them on US zeros, and I am knitting the, Is it the Atlantic Current pattern? It's not exactly the pattern, because I'm doing the regular heel, because I can't learn new things. I can, but I don't want to. It's just a show of me, like, being lazy in my thought process. It's true. It's so true. Just be reminded of it. Yes, the Atlantic Current socks. I was afraid that I was getting the names mixed up, because she also has the Rip Current mitts, which are very cute. And this is by Melissa Tuttle Sibley, who's Millie Bella. So yay, that's his paper pattern. How cute is it? Whee! And this is the, what is this? I'm trying out one of these. I know, I've never tried one before. This is a sock dock by David Dockstetter, Stater, whatever, who's the toothpick maker. He has a shop on Etsy. So I tried the fabric ones. I've tried the like little plasticky cap ones. And I'm trying this now. We'll see. This I'm kind of liking this so far, but I can't tell if it's just because it's new and novel or if I actually like it. You know what I mean? So this just got these like little rubbery bands and you just roll them out. And then their sock comes in or out. And you just lose a needle here or there. Oh, it says it's still in there. Exact opposite of what is supposed to happen. So then you just put your little guys back in there and then you just roll that down again. So I don't know. I can't decide. I like it so far, but again, it may be just because it's novel. It also does not, I mean, it fits in my sock bag, but I have to do it diagonally. So that might be a deterring factor as well. Eventually, I don't know. Okay. Since we're talking about felted things, let's talk about this thing. I am knitting from Felted Knits. It's an Interweave Press publication. Beverly Galskis, I guess, is the... Is she the pattern writer? I guess she is, because they're not individually credited. Or she is. I don't know which one she is. Anyway, this is a book from ages ago. But it has my favorite kids' knitted pattern, mitten pattern in it. They are felted mittens, but they have a non-felted cuff. They're brilliant! because if you've felted the mittens, they don't stay on. There's no elasticity in them. They're felted. But these, and it has lots of other cute patterns. Like I've made these for my husband. It has felted moccasins. I've made them for him. Anyway, this is a really cute little felted book. But, I know, right? The great thing about them is you, what you do is they have you just pick, like, you knit the mitten, which looks like this. It's a single strand of worsted weight yarn, or DK. But this is Cascade 220, which I, in my mind, is totally DK. Whatever, my kids got bigger hands than normal anyway, so. Anyway, you knit the mitten. You don't do any cuff. Now, in the pattern, they just have you cast on loosely. You finish your mitten. You go in, you go back, and pick up and knit with just cotton or something that's non-feltable. I just did a provisional crochet cast on, because that seemed easier, quite frankly, with a non-feltable yarn. So then you felt them, get them out, you take out that whatever it was, whether you picked up a knit or you did a provisional or whatever, you take that out and then pick up those stitches and then you knit the cuff after this part has already been felted. So the cuff is still knitted. And so they stay on the kid's hand. You can make the cuff as long as you want. They're short rows in the slipper. I keep saying slipper, sorry, I'm knitting through things, too many things at once. The short rows in the mitten to make this side longer. So it's not a rigid, like, it's going to sit more like that, which is more traditional, like how your hand would just rest. So that's great. What else is great? They're thick, but not so thick that you can't move them. Basically, they're the best mittens ever. Theory. For playing in the snow. And that's really what we like them for the most, because I actually have bought a couple of pairs of manufactured mittens, and they are awful. for playing in the snow because once they get wet, they do not dry, like ever, because they have that water-resistant coating on them. So inevitably, the snow gets up in them and it melts, and even if it just wicks off of a coat into the lining, that lining gets so wet, and it's murderous to try to dry it. Murderous, especially like the thumbs and stuff. These, you can take them off, put them on the vent, and like in 2 hours, they're dry, so you can go out and play again. They stay on really well, and they're warm enough. You can even put a liner under if we need to, like if we want to put a little extra protection or whatever. So yeah, and they're really not a pain in the neck to make, because they don't hurt your hands, because it's just a single strand. I'm knitting them on sevens. I think it recommends knit them on nines. it's felted. So it doesn't hurt your hands. Like sometimes the slippers hurt your hands, because I think those are knit like on 13. So they don't hurt your hands. They're not challenging to make at all. It's a little bit tricky with the provisional cast on if you're newer to this, to the rodeo, but you can figure it out. So yeah, that. So I gotta get those done before the snow comes. Okay, and I say that those were made with Cascade 220. This is number 780 or 7811. Whatever's purple. It's kind of heathery. Okay. And then the last thing, oh my gosh, I know, right? Shut up. Not you, me. The last thing I have to show you is I cast on for the Another Door Open shawl, whose human name designer is Sarah Pomegranate. Her actual human name might be Sarah Bauer. See, they're her finished object. All right. And it's a fingering weight shawl pattern. I am making mine with hand spun. How did I stop in the middle of the row for you? I never do that. Fail. Well, there's half of it-ish. Oh my gosh, really? That looks like nothing to you. Here's the middle. Okay, you can kind of, oh, whatever. Anyway, it's hand spun. These are Nanoko batlings that I got. Well, they're not batlings. It's like a color set of just dyed roving, dyed top, excuse me. And so it's in two skeins because it didn't fit on the bobbin. So this will be the outside and this will be the inside. So we're working that way. Normally I would have started with this lighter color, but the way I spun them, I don't think I was new. I think I'd been spinning for at least a year, but there's some inconsistency. So this part is a lot longer. Like this section is a lot longer than this section in terms of like the color length change. And I really like these colors the best. So I put them in the smaller part so that they would show up more. I figured if I waited until the border, they would be so skinny that it would make me sad. And then like a ton of the shawl would be this butter color, which is fine, but not my bag per se. Anyway, that's a lot of me talking. So that's very pleasant. Oh my gosh, I haven't knit a shawl in what seems like a very long time. And now I'm like, let's knit all the shawls. Oh, and look at my stitch markers. Shut up. Also from Lavender Hill Knits. There's a set with two. Oh, they're both facing away from you. Don't be jerks, Mr. Gnomes. Say hello to the people. Ugh, there's these little guys. Come on, focus. There's those little guys. And then mushrooms in the set. Normally I really prefer ring stitch markers, but come on, it's gnomes and mushrooms. I'm not gonna say no to that, and it's perfect. It was a set of six, which is exactly what I needed for the shawl. So you have four mushrooms and two gnome dudes. What up? So anyway, those made me happy. And there's no reason I don't like the dangly ones. It's just that when you're knitting back and forth, in the round, I don't mind them at all. But when you're knitting back and forth, you have to flip them over each time. Which is, again, this is a show about how I'm a lazy mental person. God, I'm so ashamed. Oh, but it's such an inherent part of my personality. I don't know that it can be changed after 36 years. I got so ill. Recording will be spotty over the next couple weeks, because it will be. Shameless self-promotion. There will be none for a while. There will be an update on January 9th, which will have the more traditional to my shop home deck fabrics. It'll have all sizes. Well, no, it won't have all sizes because it won't have the littlest size, but it'll have big, gigantic bogs and then sweater and large wedge. I think that's all. Right. Okay. I'll tell you not. Nah! I'll tell you.